So it's a pleasure to have Frank Hedek speaking today about hydrodynamic limits and duality. Please go ahead.
Thank you very much for the kind invitation. So I have to say that since I did not know which audience to exactly expect, I will be rather maybe on the elementary side, especially for the people who are working really in hydrodynamic limits. It will be a rehearsal of what they know already, probably. But I think, okay, I made this choice. And even in that respect, if there is anything unclear or whether you have supplementary questions or whatever, do not hesitate at any point to interrupt me, okay? Good, so my background is probability theory, statistical physics. So it means that also I'm approaching this issue of what is called hydrodynamic limits from that side. And so very globally speaking, what we are talking about is we have some microscopic dynamics, which is basically a stochastic microscopic dynamics. So you have to think about particles hopping on a lattice and interacting with each other in a certain way. Local interactions, and you have a conserved quantity, it's important, like the total number of particles typically is conserved. And then you want to have a macroscopic equation for the density in the limit of many particles after a proper rescaling of space and time. So it means the input is kind of this microscopic particle system, the output of this procedure should be a partial differential equation describing the evolution of the density. And of course, one of the basic first problems that you encounter then is how to define that. And so, because of course, intuitively, it is kind of clear, and these partial differential equations like the heat equation, nonlinear heat equation, conservation laws, they are of course around long before statistical mechanics even was there. So in that sense, there is a problem of definition somehow first to solve. Once you have solved that problem, you can start to talk about finer things like the deviations from the hydrodynamic limit and the large deviations from the hydrodynamic limit. So there are the normal fluctuations around the hydrodynamic limit, and then there are the large deviations from the hydrodynamic limit. So that's first the thing that I want to explain, starting from really what you know from your probability one course, in order to create a set of analogies. Yeah, so that's the thing I want to start from. So first is some basic probability theorems. And this is already with a view on what I'm going to talk about later, but it is good to have this point of view already in your head. So you know, you take a sequence of independent random variables, independent identically distributed random variables. So psi I in the natural numbers are just independent identically distributed random variables. And for all what I'm going to say, it is important, for instance, that the expectation is equal to zero, the variance is equal to one. For the last statement, which I did not yet say, so but it's also important that there is a moment generating function, so the exponential of e to the power xi I is finite, and let's say for all simplicity for all t, this is not necessary, but let's not make too much go into details. Yeah, so then we know the first thing that we know is the law of large numbers. So it means if you divide by n the sum I from 1 to n xi I, this will converge to zero in probability. So it means the probability that this deviates from zero more than epsilon goes to zero when n goes to infinity for every n. So this is what we call the law of large numbers. So it means that if you add up and sum these kind of random things, and every random thing in itself has only a contribution 1 over n, then at the end, the limit is deterministic. In this case, just a number. But this is already a kind of very simple manifestation of this phenomenon, that if you have a quantity that only weakly depends on individual random variables, then this quantity becomes non-random. Yeah, so that's called a phenomenon which you have in a very general context. So now if you think of this psi I kind of as trajectories, for instance, you can imagine that you get a deterministic trajectory in the limit. Yeah, so this is kind of very simple caricature of the fact that out of a random thing, well, after proper rescaling, comes out a deterministic thing. Yeah? So then we have a second thing, which is the central limit theorem. So this would be correspond to the hydrodynamic limit. So in the sense that the hydrodynamic limit would be a kind of infinite dimensional version of this simple law of large numbers. The CLT, so that tells you that, okay, now I know that this goes to zero, so let me subtract zero, which I don't see, of course, anymore, because it's zero. But then let me divide by looking what is the correct scale, and the correct scale is, of course, 1 over square root of n, yeah? So this goes then to a normal distribution. And so that is in another sense of convergence, although I could say here also that this is weak convergence and this is weak convergence, because weak convergence to a constant is the same as convergence in probability to a constant. But so this is called weak convergence or convergence in distribution. So this would correspond in the language of hydrodynamic limits to the fluctuations from the hydrodynamic limits. So you subtract the deterministic limit, and then you divide by another scale, which is finer than the 1 over n scale, which is the limit, the scale where everything becomes deterministic, fluctuations from the hydrodynamic limit. And you see the difference is that this limit is now a random variable. So in the language of trajectories later on, when we will talk about that, it just means that the limiting trajectory in this case will be a solution of an SPDE, yeah? So a stochastic partial differential equation instead of a partial differential equation. So there where we say the density which is of particles, for instance, which is kind of the analog of this 1 over n sum I from 1 to n xi I sum, goes to a constant that would mean to a deterministic trajectory. This kind of rescaling, so where you subtract the solution of the equation, divide by the central limit scale, it will then converge to an SPDE, which is the infinite dimensional analog of the normal distribution. And actually the natural infinite dimensional analog of the normal distribution is an infinite dimensional Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process on distributions. So it's a kind of super normal distribution, if you wish, yeah? So on a very huge space, but the principle is the same. And then you have a third thing, which is the law, which is called the large deviation principle. So this tells you the following. Let me formulate it in the simple sense here, because of course, normally you need open and closed sets and this kind of thing. So let me just formulate it in a very simple sense. Namely, if I look at the probability that this average, this empirical average, is approximately equal to X. So that means, let me be precise, nevertheless, less than or equal than X minus epsilon and greater than X minus epsilon. Then I take the logarithm of that. Then I divide by n, I take the limit n to infinity, and then the limit epsilon to zero. So this is actually, in shorthand notation, is what I call the probability that this sum, 1 over n xi normalized sum, is approximately equal to x. Yeah? That's just a notation for this business. Yes? So the probability that this is approximately is on the exponential scale, log of course. Yeah? Divided by n is on the exponential scale equal to a function minus I of x. So that means, sorry, let me write it like this because otherwise I get a bit confused maybe about this. So it just tells you that the probability that this is approximately equal to x goes like e to the minus n times I of x, e to the minus n times I of x. That's informal notation, but this notation somehow tells more than this double limit, yeah? So it just tells you the probability that this average is approximately equal to X, which is an atypical event, unless X is zero, goes exponentially in N to zero, E to the minus N, and with a certain function that depends on that X, yeah? So this I of X can actually be written explicitly, just the Legendre transform of this moment generating function. So it's a supremum over T of t times x minus the log of the expectation of e to the power x I. So there is an explicit function. You don't know, it does not matter too much what it exactly is, but once you know the distribution of the xi's, you can look at the log moment generating function, you look the Legendre transform of that, and that gives you this. So this is what people call the large deviation entropy. And so this has something to do with the optimal strategy in which you can realize that this sum is actually equal to x. So what does it mean? So this is a very atypical event. So there is there are several ways how to change the distribution so that it becomes a typical event. And the cost of this change of distribution, that is basically this exponential of n times ix. Yeah? So it's kind of the, so now, in the simplest case, this I of x is really the Boltzmann entropy in the sense of physics of the fraction x. So if you think just about coin flips where you have zeros and ones, then this I of x is simply x log x over 2 log x over 2, sorry, x log 2x plus 1 minus x log 2 1 minus x, yeah, which is the Boltzmann entropy corresponding to, they're just accounting, yeah, it's a counting problem. But of course, if you're talking about trajectories of densities or these kind of things, the philosophy is basically the same. So in the sense that the probability that the trajectory of this macroscopic quantity like the density will deviate and will be equal to a given trajectory is a very improbable event unless it is the solution of the equation. This can be written as e to the minus n times a function of this trajectory. And this function basically has the same status as here, namely it's a kind of Boltzmann entropy of how, what is the optimal strategy to realize that trajectory. Yeah? So, that is, so these kind of things I wanted to tell, because even if they are the elementary probability things that most of you know, it's about the analogy here. Yeah? So it's about the analogy. So this would correspond to large deviations from the hydrodynamic limit.
Excuse me, Frank, can I ask a silly question?
Yes.
So you're talking about trajectories, but your x variable is just a phase space variable, no? It's just a single position, a point in phase space.
Yeah, so I'm talking about vectors. Analogies, yes. I'm talking about analogies. So so this is the law of large numbers, and of course, just a number. Yeah, so just talking about the number, but you have to think of the hydrodynamic limit as an infinite dimensional version of that. So instead of having an average of numbers, you have kind of a trajectory that weakly depends on individual trajectories of the underlying particles. And that's the same idea. So it's a kind of average of trajectories.
Okay.
And so the limit is zero, then means that the limit will become something deterministic. Yeah. So it will become the solution of a deterministic partial differential equation. So it's just an infinite dimensional version of the same thing. So I'm talking about very simple things in R value random variables. But if you transpose it to trajectories of distributions, then actually it's exactly this which is happening. Yeah. So this is the.
But just for my understanding, I mean, if you talk about trajectories and you talk about a large deviation, I think the proper word is the action of the trajectory that comes into play.
Well, it depends on the context. So if you're talking about Markovian large deviations, the answer is yes. So, but you have to think of a cost of a trajectory indeed. So the analog of the rate function on one phase space variable, as you were saying, which is the Boltzmann entropy, the analog of this for trajectories would be something like a trajectory cost indeed, which in the case of Markovian processes would be of additive form, namely an integral from zero to t of something at time t, depending on speed and position of the.
Yeah, okay, thanks. That was just for understanding. Thanks.
Okay, so that was the first thing, elementary probability with some analogies towards the subject I'm going to talk about. Now, in order to make that a bit more concrete, let me also immediately introduce the kind of particle systems I'm talking about. And later on, I will be even more concrete, of course, but in the sense that I will precise the rates, etc. But for the moment, I want to be not too much precise, but just want to say. So we have a lattice, which in the picture is just a one-dimensional lattice. On this lattice, we put particles at every side. So let's say, for instance, this particle has three sides. There will be models where there is a maximal number of particles per side. That can even depend from side to side. So let's say this is a typical configuration of the particles. Yeah? So on every lattice side, for instance, here there is no particle. It's still a side, but it's an empty side. So that's what we call eta. So this is just a map from Z to the natural numbers, or a subset of the natural numbers when there are restrictions. So that's what we call the configuration. And this configuration is going to evolve in a certain way, which I will precise in a moment, which basically consists of that the particles are hopping randomly from side to side and interacting somewhat with each other in various ways, which I will explain. So it gives you a configuration process then. Yeah? So it gives you the Markov process of the configuration. So that will be some random process that where this whole configuration is evolving. So it doesn't mean, of course, that the particles individually, they will not be Markovian, of course, because they are interacting, but the whole configuration is a Markov process. So that means, in words, that if you know the whole configuration at time t, then that totally determines the distribution of the configuration in the future. That's what I mean by Markov. Good, so the Markovian evolution. And then I'm looking at, I want to define microscopic quantities associated to that. So the microscopic quantities. Associated to that. To eta t, to this process. So in order to define a microscopic quantity, I need a rescaling variable that kind of represents the ratio between length scale in the micro world and length scale in the macro world. That's actually the opposite. So the length scale of the macro world divided by length scale of the micro world. And so that I will call n. So n is the rescaling parameter, which will go to infinity at the end. And so I will then define the density field as follows. So this is 1 over n to the power d, sum I from I in z of the number of particles at time tn squared at location I, and then that weighted delta I over n. So let me explain what that is. Because this is now something. So it means that every particle I weight with the factor 1 over n to the d. So every particle weights, if you wish, 1 over n to the d kilogram. And then I put it at the location I over n. So it means that I stretch the space. So it means the micro space and the macro space, they have ratio 1 over n. And then, so I just have the mass distribution in that scale. Yeah, so this is the mass distribution at that scale. Then I look at the time scale, which is also rescaled, because it's natural, because if a time scale microscopically, there are only some hops of particles, it will not change this quantity. So in order to change this quantity, that you see something, you need to speed up time. And I do this for this talk with n squared, because it will be a symmetric particle system. So I'm anticipating on the scaling of the diffusion equation. Yes? That's the reason I speed up time diffusively and space like 1 over n. Yeah? So this is what you call the empirical distribution at scale n.
Sorry, can I just ask something? What does d stand for?
The small delta.
No, d. N to the power d.
Ah, the d is the dimension. Yes, so we are on zd, let's say.
Okay.
So indeed, in the picture d was 1, so that just
sure.
And it corresponds to this, you know, this 1 over n here, yeah. So of the law of large numbers somehow. If you would have a field of identically distributed things, you would have to divide by 1 over n to the d.
So Frank, can I also ask a question?
Yes.
In the previous, with the large deviations, I was expecting to somehow arrive at some asymptotic equipartition or something. But does that apply here or not?
So it means that, this is when you condition. So when you condition the measure on this event, then let's say that you are in the simple coin flip situation and you condition the coin flip measure on this event, then you will converge to the uniform measure on that constraint somehow. That is an equivalence of ensembles result, if you wish. So if you condition the uniform distribution on coin flips to have increases an average of 1/3, Then in the limit n to infinity, the two descriptions are, the following two descriptions are equivalent. One is saying, okay, I have a biased coin which produces me an average of 1/3, and I just take IID copies of this coin, that is one. That's what you would call the grand canonical ensemble. And if you condition this event, so this, the uniform measure on all these configurations, that's actually the same thing. All these configurations which have an average of 1/3. Is that an answer to your question? So in that sense, indeed, there is equipartition, yes.
Okay, yes. No,
you, of course, start from the flat measure as a reference measure. That's an important thing. So.
Okay, I think it makes sense. I was just trying to make sure this is not different than what I thought it would be. All right, thank you very much.
So this is now... This trajectory here is, so now I have to think of this as a trajectory. So it means that I take time also between two fixed macroscopic times, zero t. So then I can think of this as a trajectory, a random trajectory, more precisely. So it's a random trajectory because the process eta t will be random of distributions. So that's what I meant by the kind of infinite dimensional analog. Yeah, so this, instead of having just one number, I just have a whole trajectory of distributions. Yeah, so in the sense that this thing I can integrate. And so if I integrate a function, phi of x, against this distribution, so it actually tells you nothing, but so this is an integral over Rd then. This is nothing but 1 over into the d, sum I in Zd, the function evaluated in I over m, and then multiply it with I, t n squared. So you can think of this also as a field. So you put in a test function and you get out this number. So, and you are interested in limiting behavior of this field. Time-dependent field, that's another way to think about it. Okay, so then what is the hydrodynamic limit? First of all, what is the hydrodynamic limit? So that is telling that if at time zero, mu n zero converges to rho x dx. So rho is now a function of x on Rd. Yeah? So it means that this measure at time zero converges in the weak sense. So it means if I test it with a, if I integrate it against the test function, it converges to the integral of that with respect to the test function. So that is, if this is true, so that means that there is an initial profile, initial density profile. There's a well-defined initial density profile. Then also the whole trajectory. So let me first have the weak statement. So that tells me that for every t, this converges to rho tx dx, where rho tx solves the equation. And now for this talk, it will also be always be the heat equation. Okay, so it will be 1/2, and there will be a d, and then it will, because it's when dimensional. Yeah, okay, let me put it general. Yes, so here the sum, I have to 1 to d, Laplacian, 1/2 d, Laplacian rho. So this is the statement of the hydrodynamic limit for, and this holds for all t. So that's the first kind of weakest statement. It just tells you that for every t, there is again a well-defined density profile. And this density profile is the solution of an equation with initial condition rho, yeah? So with rho zero equal to this given rho. So that is the first statement. So
can I ask you something?
Yes.
So obviously this is what you want to show, or
yeah. So it's a statement, a definition. So as I said, the first problem is the how to define this. Yeah.
Yeah.
What does it exactly mean that there is a macroscopic PDE? Well, that's the statement.
Okay.
Can I also ask a question, yes, for understanding? I mean, is it true that this rho is the steady state solution to the equation?
No.
It's not.
It's about rho is something. Initially, rho of x is arbitrary. So you distribute your particles in a certain way so that the macroscopic profile is well defined. So it means, for instance, you can put with probability 1/2 a particle on the left of the origin, everywhere independently, and with probability 2/3 a particle on the right. So then you have a kind of profile that goes like this. Yeah? So it's 1/2 left and it's 2/3 right. That's an allowed initial profile for the heat equation.
Yeah. Sure. But I mean, because it becomes time independent.
No, it's because there is a time t, you know? So there's zero, here is zero, and here is t, and here is also t.
Okay, so it's time dependent. Okay, thanks.
It's time dependent. Yeah, so it's the microscope. The difference
is. I understand. Now, so it's a microscopic, the macroscopic density time dependent profile. Right. Okay.
Yes, a microscopic time dependent profile. So that's the weakest statement, that for every t there is again a profile, and this profile is the solution of the equation. Second statement is, and usually this statement is a kind of, you get it from that one with some extra things, which are usually of technical nature, is that the whole trajectory actually, this whole trajectory. So this is, as we said, a random distribution value trajectory converges to the trajectory concentrating on this. So that basically means, this is for every t, so for every big t, so it means the whole trajectory converges, so there's a random trajectory, converges to the deterministic trajectory, which concentrates on the solution of the equation. Yeah? So this is just this first statement, but uniformly in t. So if you think of it from a technical point of view, that it's not only saying that for every t you have convergence, but also uniformly in t you have convergence.
Sorry, can I ask a question?
Yes.
So you said that that your density depends basically on the initial condition that you have.
Yes.
But would the form of the equation can also depend on the initial condition, or the form of the equation is independent of the initial condition?
The form of the equation is independent of the initial condition, usually, yes.
So in the end, what you get is just the PDE with an initial condition that is exactly the corresponding one to the initial condition of the density profile.
So this statement here is that's a condition that you start from. So you have to have a well-defined density profile initially. And then there are also strengthening of this in the sense that there are some results saying that even if you start from a deterministic configuration, which is not yet has a well-defined density, then immediately at time t positive, macroscopic time t positive, a well-defined density profile installs and propagates. But this is a stronger statement, but this can happen also. But this is the condition, yes. And this is then in exactly the initial condition of the limiting PDE. So the second statement is about deviations from the hydrodynamic limit. Sorry, fluctuations. So this is usually done in equilibrium, at least in the standard setting. But with the kind of systems that we are talking about, we can also treat non-equilibrium settings here. So what it is, so you take, now I call that y and t. So I try to have as many, as little things as possible, but so I will have a distribution that depends on n and t. So it's a trajectory of distributions again. And when it's applied to a test function, so it is phi is a test function, so phi is a function from Rb to R, and think of it as a Schwarz function, for instance, smooth and going to zero at infinity, fast enough, faster than any polynomial. So then I define this thing. So I just take the same eta I at time n squared t. I weight it with, and now I subtract rho. Sorry, let me subtract just the expectation so that I don't have to. No, let me subtract rho t of I over n. And then I multiply this with phi I over n. And then I multiply that with 1 over n to the power d over 2. Sorry. So the scaling became 1 over square root of n to the d. So I take again this field that I had initially. I know that this is going to converge to the integral of phi of x times rho dx. So now I anticipate by subtracting exactly that thing. So this would be the kind of central limit scaling then. So then the question is, then the statement is that this converges. So this converges. again, in the sense of weak convergence, if you wish, of the whole trajectory even, to a solution of the following form. So it will be dy t equals Laplacian, 1/2 Laplacian d times Laplacian y t, plus a term which will depend on rho. So I actually have to write here something like chi of rho of t, and then a square root, and then I have something like nabla dwt, which is something like the gradient of white noise. Yeah, so it's not so important that you, for the moment, you know the technical details of this symbol, but think of it as a kind of a gradient of a space-time Brownian motion, gradient in space. And so this is a distribution value thing. And it, the fact that there is this nabla has to do with the conservation law again. Yeah, so the fact that you don't have really white noise itself, but rather nabla of white noise, has to do with the fact that you have an underlying conservation law. And so this rho t is again the, what you find in the hydrodynamic limit. So in the hydrodynamic limit, you find a certain solution of the equation, which is rho t. That's the thing you have to insert here. And this is something like the susceptibility, which for the moment, again, is not so important to understand. The most important thing is that you get an equation, which is this part you recognize, just the heat equation that you had before. But now there is a noise term that is added to this. And so it gives you something like a linear equation. So this is linear here, this infinite dimensional, but linear. And then you have an additional noise term. So it's something like an infinite dimensional Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process. Yeah, an Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process, also something of the form. There is a dt missing, by the way. Dyt is something linear times yt dt plus noise. Yeah, so that's Ornstein-Uhlenbeck. And so this is an infinite dimensional version of Ornstein-Uhlenbeck. So that's typically what you want to find on the level of fluctuations. And then for the large deviations, that's the last thing. I'm just defining what the things are. I'm not proving anything so far. I'm just defining what the things are. So large deviations from the hydrodynamic limit. Hydrodynamic limit. So how would you define that? Well, you go back to this field here, mu 1 t. And you are interested in the probability that mu 1 t is given, is a given trajectory. So let me use a little bit of informal notation here. So this trajectory of this macroscopic density field, the probability that is approximately equal to a given trajectory, that you want that this goes like e to the minus n to the power d, a certain function, which now, since it's living on trajectories, let me put a large I. So that means every trajectory has a individual trajectory, has a cost which is given by this function. And this function is typically of the following form. So I'm not going to write too much details, but typically the function is of the following form. Integral from 0 to t and an integral over space of what? So you take the, if this thing solves the heat equation, so this thing should be 0. Yeah? Laplacian, sorry, d times Laplacian again at t. So if this follows the heat equation, the cost should be 0, because you know that's a typical equation. So it means that this will have probability 1. So it means that the I has to be 0. So it will be some kind of a norm squared, more precisely, norm squared, and will be a factor 1/2. Again, that's not so important. For there's an integral over dt, integral over dx. And then there is a norm that also depends on the gamma dx. And, so and this norm, yeah, okay, that depends on which model you have, yeah, which norm this is exactly. But it's of the form, so it's something quadratic in the deviation from the hydrodynamic limit. So you take gamma dot t 1/2 d Laplacian gamma t. So this would be 0 if gamma satisfies the hydrodynamic equation. So you take this quantity and you take a certain norm squared of that quantity that depends on itself on gamma tx. For instance, okay, let me say what the norm is. If you have independent particles, for instance, independent particles, then this norm would be the following. So you have a norm rho, which would be simply the integral of lambda phi squared of x times rho of x dx. So that's a norm. And then you take this, the norm that we are talking about here is then the dual norm of this. So let me call this minus, yeah? Minus rho is in the dual norm of this. So that's the typical kind of norms that you will encounter. Yeah? So for the moment, don't worry too much about the precise definitions of this norm. The most important thing that you have to see is that it's a quadratic function. And this is, of course, kind of consistent with what you find here. Although, so it's in some sense, the large deviation principle is consistent with the central limit theorem. So it means that here you find a quadratic function, which is kind of consistent with the fact that here you find a Gaussian field. Okay, so that was definitions. And you see that I need some time to have the definitions, which indeed is one of the basic problems. Once you have stated exactly what you mean by this is the hydrodynamic limit, this is the fluctuations from the hydrodynamic limit, this is the large deviation principle, you can really start to work out concrete models. And that's the second half of my talk, unless there are still remarks or questions that I did not take yet. Good. So then there is another statement which I wanted to say under four. Yes, under four, which is something that in particular for the models which share a property, which I will introduce in a minute, which is called duality, is important, is what's called propagation of chaos or propagation of local equilibrium. So that means the following. So if you have, so the models that we are going to discuss, they will have invariant measures indexed by the density. But does it mean? So it means that since there is a conserved quantity, these models will typically have non-unique invariant measures. Namely, for every value of the density, you will have a unique ergodic measure, invariant measure that has that density. For the simple models would be, for instance, just the Bernoulli measure with density rho. So we put a particle with probability rho at every side, independently of every side. So, and that carries an index. And this index has to do with the fact that there's a conserved quantity underlying. Yeah? So these are the invariant measures. So it means that this, for the invariant measures, this rho is just constant, everywhere the same, which corresponds to also to the limiting solution of the heat equation. The heat equation at the end produces a constant in the limit. So now you can look at corresponding local equilibrium measures. So that's that would be that instead of putting new rho, where the same rho at every side, you take at every side a new, but with a parameter that weakly depends on the side. So that is what you call the local equilibrium measure. So you select the marginal of the measure new, but with a parameter that depends on x weakly in the sense that you divide by n. So there is this. So it means that only when x varies over a distance n, this measure really changes. So that's what you call a local equilibrium measure. And then you can ask yourself how that propagates in time. So that it means that let's put this measure. So I take here a product because in the models that I will be talking about, actually these equilibrium measures are product measures. So it means that in the limit, in the stationary state, the occupation variables, the number of particles at every side will become independent. So that's why I put here a product. Yeah. So now take the product over x. So I take this local equilibrium measure and I evolve it. So let me say that when I evolve the process, that this measure gets evolved. Yeah? So because I evolve the process, so initially I distribute it like that, I evolve my process. And so that's why I will call S n squared t. So it means that I evolve this probability measure over a time n squared t. Then propagation of local equilibrium tells you that this is approximately equal to the same local equilibrium distribution. The only difference is that you have a rho t. where rho t solves the hydrodynamic equation. So this is, in some sense, it's not totally, there is a symmetric difference between this statement and the hydrodynamic limit statement in the following sense, that you would expect that the hydrodynamic limit kind of follows from this statement, in the sense that if you start from local equilibrium, then you keep local equilibrium, and therefore, because you have a local equilibrium, you have the law of large numbers at every macroscopic time. That's the idea. But in some sense, this is a stronger statement, yeah. So because it tells you really that the whole probability measure is propagating in the course of time, not only there is a law of large numbers, but really the whole measure is looking like an equilibrium where only the parameter is evolving. So this is what typically, if people are talking about hydrodynamics, that's what they think about. So if you start from a non-equilibrium setting, you need some time, and after this time, locally there is equilibrium, but the parameter of the equilibrium distribution locally depends on time, but in microscopic units, and then that parameter is the only thing that still evolves, and nothing else is evolving. That is the picture. And so this picture can, in general, so one of the aims, of course, is what do you mean by this? Well, it would mean that if you integrate a local function, so for instance, the number of particles at the origin or something against this measure and against that measure, the difference would go to zero. That's what, so local observables look the same under both measures. So that is what is called propagation of chaos or propagation of local equilibrium. Good, now let me talk about the models. And I think that, good. So I will go from a configuration eta, which again is in the state space that I had before. So that would be n ZD. I have at every set, every site in ZD, a certain number of particles, and that gives me the whole configuration. So I will precise the rates at which this moves from removing a particle at X and putting a particle at Y. So these are the only moves that I allow. So there's just a particle that moves from. So and it will happen at a certain rate. So the rate is in terms of probability Markovian theory, just saying the probability per unit of time. So, yeah, something like that. So this goes at rate eta x, so there has to be a particle, of course, it's proportional to the number of particles at x. And then there is a parameter, alpha, which in the most general case is allowed even to depend on y, the arrival site. And then there is another parameter, sigma, that's the kind of models that we can treat with the techniques that I explained in the last. I don't know, by the way, how much time I still have.
About 20 minutes.
Ah, good. So I was thinking of less. So in that sense, I'm still okay.
What is sigma?
Yeah. So I'm going to tell, of course, what this all is. So alpha wise, which, by the way, after the first two minutes of introduction, I will take constant over y. For the simplicity, I'm just telling you that it is allowed to depend on y for all the things that I'm going to tell. So that's just a positive number. And that's kind of the rate of the underlying random walk. So if this term here, the sigma eta y, is not there, it just tells you that you have independent random walkers that move. And I, of course, also need a pxy. So there are independent random walkers that move at rate pxy alpha y from x to y. So the rate depends. So it's something like the attraction parameter, if you wish. Every side y has a kind of attraction parameter with which it's attracted to the van der Waal. And then pxy is to be symmetric. That's very important for what I'm going to say. Sigma is plus or minus one or zero. So these distinguish three cases. Zero is called independent random walkers. Minus one is called exclusion process. And actually a generalized exclusion process in the sense that you allow a maximum number of particles per site that depends on the site. So for every y, there is alpha y as the maximum number of particles. So then this alpha y has to be an integer also, otherwise the model does not make sense. So then alpha y has to be an integer. So it means that you just have for every site a maximum number of particles that you allow. If we have a one, then it's called SIP, inclusion process, symmetric inclusion process, and there this parameter is one, and then the alpha can be arbitrary, and that is then attracting. So it's a kind of, if you think about this as a fermionic system, in the sense that there is a maximal number of particles, so this reminds a bit of Pauli exclusion principle, etc. This would be the corresponding bosonic system. Yeah? In the sense that there is attraction between the particles. The particles are favored to go to the same place. Okay, so it's a very important thing. This so there is these parameters, and it's very important that this rate for the properties that I will need. It's very important that this rate is bilinear in eta. So this is this makes some magic happen, which doesn't happen if it is not the case. So then. What is duality, so which is more precisely self-duality, which is kind of also the key for proving the hydrodynamic limit in all this context. So let me say, if I have that particle system, then you can prove the hydrodynamic limit, you can prove the fluctuations from the hydrodynamic limit, you can prove the large deviations from the hydrodynamic limit, so that the statements that I just told, you can all prove them, and rather straightforwardly, actually. And one of the reasons this is possible is this very special property of these models, which is called self-duality. So let me explain that. So let me just fall off the air. There will be something falling out of the air now, but once it is fallen, I will explain it. But, so there are certain functions, which I call d xi eta. So xi is a configuration. And also eta is a configuration, but xi is a finite number of particles. So this is a finite configuration. So it means, in particular, if you think about the evolution of xi, it's much easier than the evolution of eta in general. So eta, you have to think of an infinite configuration, and xi is a finite configuration. And then you define this function. So it's a product over sides of functions, and then this function depends on the model, and I will take two forms. Yeah, for independent random walkers, this function is simply what is called a factorial moment, so that's this form. So these functions will always be polynomials in the n variable of degree k, and factorizing over sides. So that's okay, so I just precise what they are for the different models. So if you have the SEP model, so there is this parameter alpha, remember? That's combination n over k divided by combination alpha over k. And then there is the SEP model. There it is n factorial over n minus k factorial, and then multiplied with gamma alpha over gamma alpha plus k. So it's not so important, the precise form of these functions, but what is important is that they exist. They are a bit like modifications of the factorial moments, where the modification depends on the model. So you have a modification for the SEP and a different modification for the SEP. And for the independent random walkers, it's exactly the factorial moment. So then what do these functions satisfy? The following property. If I take my process, I evolve eta and I fix xi, it's the same as evolving psi and fixing eta. So this is true for every t, for every eta, for every psi, for every t positive. So let me just illustrate this relation first, but before I start to illustrate it in more detail, let me just tell why it is an important relation. So this is what people call self-duality. And it tells you that if I want to have the expectation at time t when I start from a certain initial configuration eta, or the expectation of this function indexed by finite configurations, I can as well fix the eta. So this eta and that eta are the same. So it means this is just a thing that depends on the initial condition and the evolution of xi. Now, the evolution of xi is, of course, much more simple if you think about the finite number of particles. If psi is just a finite number of particles, what will happen is that they spread out over space. At the end, will go to infinity, typically. And so the evolution of a finite number of paths is just a finite state space, countable state space Markov chain. So this is a very simple thing. Whereas the left-hand side is infinite, is a priori infinitely many particles, which also are interacting with each other. So this is a very specific relation that simplifies a lot. And so in order to illustrate it, let me give the simplest example of this. If I take Xi to be just a configuration with one particle at X and nothing else, so there is just a particle at X and nothing else, then this relation can be rewritten as follows. It just tells me that if I look at the expected number of particles at location X at time T, so the first thing to remark is that the corresponding D function is then just proportional to eta x times some proportionality function that depends on the model, but it's not so. So the first duality function, when I have just a dual configuration xi, which is one particle, is just eta x. And so in general, how many particles I have here depends is the degree of the polynomial in the eta variable that I will have. So if I have just one particle, it's a degree one polynomial. And actually it's proportional to eta x. So then what I get is here. So this evolution here will be the evolution of this itself, but it's only one particle. So one particle is just doing a random walk. So I just have Ex, random walk expectation starting from X of eta at time zero, which is that eta actually, at position Xt. Which is, if you wish, explicitly expressible as this transition probability of continuous time random walk to go from X to Y, eta Y. So it means that the expected number of particles at position X at time T is just a linear combination of the numbers of particles at time zero with weights, which are just given by transition probabilities of one random walker. So that's a very special property, but it's a very interesting property, of course. Is it clear this? Because that's and so basically this duality is just a generalization of that to more particles. So you can take the product of etas at different sites, and then you have a similar relation, but then you have to have, instead of ptxy with one particle, you will have ptx1 to xn, y1 to n for n particles. That's basically but so this is a basic simplification, which
could I ask a question about this?
Yes.
So I'm not entirely sure if I understand everything, so this might be a naive question again. Does it have anything to do with microscopic reversibility and with the balance equation? Because it seems like you're propagating particle densities with this P of T and somehow come to such a statement. So I don't know what your view on that is. I'm trying to understand.
Yeah, I understand. So. Of course, you have a conservation law, that I agree. But in a priori, it is not clear that the expectation of eta x at time t is just a function of the same eta y's. I mean, you could imagine that there are terms where there is eta x, eta y, and there is a term, for instance, eta x plus one, and a term eta x plus one, eta x plus two. So it's more like a microscopic closeness of the equation for this. So if you look at the DDT of this equation, if you look at the expected number of particles at time t, there is an input and an output, but both of course contain other terms because there is interaction. So it's not closed normally in this variable. However, it happens to be just closed in this variable for that particular situation. So that you find essentially this equation. We just find a closed equation in this set of functions. So all the functions of degree one, when you take the derivative of the expectation, remain of degree one. So if you think of it in physical terms, it's a BBJKY hierarchy, which is closed microscopically already. So that makes the model very special because detailed balance is more general. Many detailed balance models which will not satisfy this.
Okay, yeah, thanks.
But does this mean that this is true for interacting for I mean you made the drawing of the system of the particles just moving left and right, but it is true also for interacting particle systems. So they are allowed to interact with one another.
These particular rates, yeah. So these rates, they induce an interaction of a specific nature.
I see. So for these specific interactions, this
interaction, I have this. No, of course, in general, you don't have this.
I see. Okay.
This might be a subject, if you wish, of another talk. But what do you do if you don't have this microscopic closeness? Then you have already a problem straight from the beginning, which is rather heavy, yeah, and which takes a lot of time to solve. But let me just say that this relation, how that relation now implies the hydrodynamic limit. Yeah, so that's the last 3 minutes. So let me just take the following. So let me look out at this field that I was introducing, phi x over n, sum over x. Okay, it wasn't sum over I actually, but okay, it's the same. And so then I take this eta at x at time n squared t, and I divide by n to the power d. So let me just try to use this relation here to prove to you that if I take the expectation of that, that this indeed converges to the solution of the heat equation when n goes to infinity. Okay, so I have to have an assumption, an initial assumption. So let me assume something which is that initially, so eta x at time zero, that is equal to rho x over n. So this corresponds to having a well-defined initial profile. Yeah. So at time zero, it is this thing. So then I have 1 over n to the power d, sum over x, phi of x over n. And then I have here the expectation starting from eta. So what is this expectation actually? This E is actually an expectation with respect to the initial condition and then integrated out over the initial distribution. Yeah. So it means there are actually two expectations. There is first the expectation over the initial eta and then the expectation over the trajectory starting from eta. That's why I have this E eta here. And then I have to integrate that with respect to my initial measure, un d eta. So what is that? So that's 1 over n to the d. So this one, I know now because of what I just told about this duality, that this is the same as the expectation for a simple random walk of eta at position x of this simple random walk at time n squared t integrated with respect to nu and d eta. So now this is the one at time zero, yeah? So that's the same as this eta I'm integrating over. So this is nothing but rho of x n squared t over n. And let me just put this index x to remember that this random walk was starting from x, so I have to take the expectation. And now this random walk, I take the expectation with respect to this random walk. Yeah, so this is this expectation with respect to this random walk, and just take out of it the integral. And this is the integral of eta over this u n, which produces me this rho over n. Yeah, I get 1 over n to the power d, sum over x, phi x over n, and I get density profile at the position xx n squared t. So this is the same as x plus x zero n squared t by translation invariance, say, in the simplest setting again. And the expectation is now with respect to the random walk starting at the origin. Now this random walk, when I rescale it like this, it will converge to Brownian motion. That is basically the central limit theory for one particle, just one random walk. So that will converge to Brownian motion. And so what I find here is nothing but the integral in the limit n to infinity is a Riemann approximation of the integral of phi of x, expectation of rho of x plus Brownian motion, starting from zero, of course, and then integrated over x. But you know that this is a representation of the solution of the heat equation. So this is nothing but the solution of d rho dt equals 1/2 d Laplacian rho t. It's a probabilistic representation of this solution. So you find indeed that the expectation converges to the solution. And then, of course, the next step in order to prove all these things with trajectories even and in probability, etc., is to prove that this expectation is also the limit if you remove the expectation from the beginning. So this is a law of large number result basically telling that the variance goes to zero. But you remember, this is kind of an average. So it's an average and the dynamics is local. So you can imagine that for x's which are extremely far from each other, these things are more or less independent. And because of that, this variance goes to zero. So this thing also without expectation will converge. And so then we have it for every t. And then the only extra thing to do is that you have it uniformly in t. And that's a technical martingale story, which is not difficult. It's basically computing the quadratic variation of a martingale associated to this. And then you are finished. So the rest is technicality somehow. That's what I want to say. So this is the essential point, that because of this duality, you can reduce this expectation to something which is only to do with the profile at time zero and a random walk. And because the random walk scales to Brownian motion, this gives you the heat equation. And I think I'm stopping here because otherwise, I mean, of course, we can add many, many things. But for instance, this step here, I made it and I kind of assumed then that suddenly that alpha is constant. If alpha is not constant, this random walk is a little bit more complicated because it's a random walk, a random environment, depending on alphas. But still, you can show that you have the central limit theorem or the invariance principle for this random walk. So it means that this step, which I wanted to explain, is that for that kind of models, the solution of the hydrodynamic limit problem is equivalent with the invariance principle for one random walk. And that is then usually another story, which in the case so that alphas are constant, just a standard invariance principle, random walk converges to Brownian motion. If the alpha is not constant, it's a random walk, a random environment story, which in itself is interesting and difficult sometimes, and which can even have non-diffusive limits. When alphas become very large, for instance, you can have traps and all kinds of things. But the point, because of this duality, it reduces to this one particle problem, this whole hydrodynamic limit. And that is the message I wanted to finish with.
Thank you.
So thanks.
Does anyone have any questions?
I had a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
If I remember correctly, this is more also related to the philosophy of emergence. If I remember correctly, there are different microscopic models that can lead to the same hydrodynamic limit.
Yeah.
Maybe this is not so much a question, but a remark to how is that then interpreted in terms of, the theory of emergence and reduction? If you have different microscopic models that are leading to the same hydrodynamic limits, how do you distinguish between those?
Well, so you have a D here in the equation. Yeah? So in this particular setting, yeah. So you have, of course, restricted to already many specific models, etc. But if you wish, there are more microscopic parameters even in the models that I introduced than there are macroscopic parameters in the hydrodynamic limit, because there is alpha, a whole profile of alphas. There is a sigma, and there is a PXY. So all these things they are there, and in the limit you only have D. So it's that kind of reduction, which you also have in statistical mechanics. So if you think about, there could be many models which have more or less the same macroscopic behavior. So it's not that you can really infer the microscopic details of the interactions from the micro. So this reduction is typical for statistical mechanics, I would say.
Mm-hmm.
Is there another question?
I was curious whether this methodology, what is, you know, how far stretching it is, in the sense that it seems to me like this duality relation is, as you said, I guess in physics speak, is like that there is some sort of well-defined closed equation for the one particle density or something like that, like in this BGKY hierarchy, as you were saying. But in physics, we would expect that under much milder circumstances, there exists a hydrodynamic limit.
Absolutely, and this is also the case, but it's a story then of the closure of the equation. And that's a story a bit longer than an hour. That's the only thing. But I mean, there is an enormous amount of models where the equation is not closed, and you can make it closed on the hydrodynamic scale. And this is a large deviation problem, basically. You show that these things which appear in this equation, when averaged over macroscopic blocks, they actually become a function of the density with very high probability. And but that is the method of Gua, Papanicolaou, Varadhan, for instance. And this is really a generic. So this is very special, but in some sense also not very special, because you can also go beyond by looking at perturbations. And you can say, okay, you have weakly asymmetric models, for instance, you can treat with this weak interaction different from that one. So as long as you are adding terms which are of order 1/n to this, in a very vague sense now I'm talking, you can still do it. And so in that sense, you can still add reactions, for instance, Glauber, Kawasaki-like processes, so reaction diffusion systems you can still obtain, you can still obtain asymmetric systems. So, because at the end, you need this duality only on the macro scale somehow. So you can imagine if you have a 1/n perturbation of this thing, you can actually use a perturbative-like approach. And this is actually the approach of the Masi-Presutti in the late 80s, which then at some point got overwhelmed by the method of Varadhan, which is based on the estimation of relative entropy with respect to local equilibrium states. But I didn't want to go into that method in this talk because it's really very technical. So I need 2 hours for that if you want to know that method.
I guess in physics, we might think that if we have a deterministic model, which is ergodic, that there should, even in that case, be some sort of hydrodynamic limit. We probably need to take some double scaling limit of the volume to infinity and scale that faster than the time scales or something like that. But you might believe that that's maybe like the ultimate dream of a physicist, is the proof that generic ergodic systems are well described by hydrodynamics, but that seems to be very far from the types of, because you start already with like a stochastic model to begin with, right, Markov?
Yes, but that I have to say, okay, so I was talking because I wanted to somehow to present the simplest model in which one can do this, but on the scale of kind of models for which one can do this, suppose that you would have this just random jumping, but instead of random jumping, you have an underlying a dynamical system like 2x mod 1, for instance, that determines in which direction you will jump. Then you can make it purely deterministic, and you can basically show the same thing. Okay. So there are several works by Dolgopiat, Kupiainen, Liverani, who really start from deterministic systems. However, as you say, and we cannot treat a generic Hamiltonian system. Infinitely many particles evolving according to Newtonian equations, that would be the ideal to prove that they converge to the heat equation after proper rescaling. So that no one can do.
Yeah, okay.
But there are specific purely deterministic systems, so you don't need stochasticity necessarily. The idea is that in a deterministic system, the stochasticity is replaced by the uncertainty on the initial micro configuration. So if you only specify the initial density profile, it still leaves many configurations. So there is an initial probability distribution. And because of the chaos of this microscopic motion, this will propagate and will be enough to have ergodicity at every time.
I see. Okay, I see. Okay.
That's the idea, but this only works for certain coupled map lattices or for certain kind of toy Hamiltonian systems. Like there is also, of course, hard spheres. For hard spheres, you can also.
Yeah. So this could almost be like an intermediate level description between the deterministic model and the hydrodynamic model, this particular description.
Yeah.
Interesting. Thank you.
And how far away are people from actually getting Navier-Stokes or something?
Yeah, Navier-Stokes is another problem because First of all, again, there is a problem of definition. What it exactly means in such systems to get the Navier-Stokes equation? So usually it is a correction to the Eulerian scaling. So first of all, if there is a system, yeah. So I have to be careful with what I'm saying. So in stochastic particle systems, there are very few results on Navier-Stokes. I mean, to my knowledge, actually only one, which is a paper by Elise Jeanfraisse and Claudio Landin, who have a particular zero range like process where they can prove a correction to the hydrodynamic limit, which can be interpreted as Navier-Stokes. So there is again already a problem how to define what you mean by that the Navier-Stokes equation is the hydrodynamic limit, because it's never the hydrodynamic limit. The hydrodynamic limit is just Euler equation. So you have to take another equation, you have to take another limiting procedure in order to arrive there. And this is in general done for very few systems.
Yeah, you're saying that it comes at some kind of
equation, nonlinear heat equation.
You say it comes at some kind of correction, but it's none of the corrections you're talking about. It's not large deviation.
No. It's indeed a correction where there are parameters in the model which are scaled together with. I mean, it has to do with the viscosity. Yeah? So you have to have some parameter that models the viscosity, and then in certain limit of that parameter, you find this equation as a correction to the hydrodynamic limit. But so it's different from, here it's just a story of what is the hydrodynamic limit, what is the fluctuations from the hydrodynamic limit, but so the Navier-Stokes is still a deterministic equation. So. Of course, there are also particle systems associated to the Navier-Stokes equation in two dimensions. For instance, you can have these cascades on the Fourier modes, which can be modeled in themselves as particle systems. Mm-hmm. But this is then the other way around. Yeah? You start from the equation and generate a kind of a particle system which you can describe the equation.
Right. Does anyone have any other questions?
Maybe a quick last one. Are there any results on particle systems that have the Kuramoto model as a hydrodynamic limit?
I think the Kuramoto model might arise as, you know, there are this kind of many particle limits where you do not have to rescale time. No? So, I mean, like, for instance, how to derive equations of balance so you have a model where you have molecules, for instance, of different types, which are evolving stochastically, and then you take initially many, many molecules so that you have a kind of concentration description. And I think probably this model could be a limit of that kind of models rather, because it's a system of ODEs, no? So it's, or I don't know exactly what, maybe I didn't understand well your question.
I mean a discrete model. So maybe we can talk about this another time.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, is there any other question? If not, then let's thank Frank again. Thanks a lot.
Thank you all for the invitation. Yeah.